Thank you. Thank you for the introduction. And like they mentioned already, I'm Judella Haddad-Lacle, associate professor. I don't have anything to disclose. And the objective, so at the end of today, I'm hoping that everybody in here will understand the importance to vaccinate, because that's what we're going to be talking about, right? Immunization, how important it really is. What vaccines are recommended for adults, because most of us think children, they have to go when they're babies.
I'm going to interrupt you because there's a terrible echo.
Echo. So can we try without it?
Yes. I think if you don't mind, we're going to try without this second microphone,
yeah,
which seems to be a problem, besides sounding like the electric guitar that I cannot play.
Let's see here.
Let's try that.
Okay, because I can speak very loudly. Yay! And I feel more natural now. Thank you. Yes. So yeah, so by the end, you know, hopefully everybody will understand what vaccinations are recommended for adults. Also the impact that the vaccines have on your community. Not only for you, but what it means to be immunized. And I want to touch then between all of us some myths and facts about the immunizations. So, do I really need shots? What do you think?
Yes.
Yes. Yes. And why? This is a picture from smallpox. I don't know if anybody has seen that before, but this was before we eradicated smallpox from the world, because we don't have smallpox anymore. The baby was immunized, but mom was not immunized. So this is the smallpox that we can see. So I think it's important for everybody to realize that immunizations do save lives, do eradicate diseases. It helps prevent diseases. So, why is it important? Since this is interactive, you can, you know, interrupt me, and I want to talk so I get all your feelings too. Why is vaccination important? Prevented epidemic, exactly. So, to contribute to illnesses, but also to mortality, because some of these, when you reach certain age, some of these diseases are deadly. Like the flu shot can be a deadly disease if you're over 65. Also, they prevent hospitalization, because when you're sick, you need to go to the hospital. That's a day's work. So it's, you know, it will interact with you there. It helps you to stay healthy, help you from missing work or school. That's why we need it. And very important, not all vaccine lasts a lifetime. So the immunity may fade away. And that's why it's important for us to kind of get the booster so you can get protected again. And also, there are some new vaccines that we didn't have before. Anybody can think of one? Shingles, exactly. Yep, HPV, exactly. Our first cancer vaccine that we have now. So, you know, it has been developed with years by protecting not only children, but also adults. And that's why it's so important to have adults be immunized. And it helps keep disease from spreading from people to people that are not able to get their vaccines. For example, if you're going to be a grandmother, that newborn child has not received any vaccines. So they can be exposed to anything. They don't get, the only vaccines a baby currently gets is their hepatitis in the hospital. But from there, it's not until 2 months. So if you have, for example, we talked about the shingles, and you go see your grandchild, you can give your grandchild chickenpox, because shingles is a chickenpox vaccine. Whooping cough, it's coming back. That's one of the vaccines that we think it's coming back as adults, that it's fading away, so you can give your grandchild or somebody in the community that is pregnant with a newborn baby, you can give them the whooping cough. So that's why it's important to vaccinate. Now, how do they work? Anybody, any guesses? Yeah, so then your body is going to respond to it. So It prepares your body to fight the disease without exposing you to the symptoms. For example, we have either a bacteria or a virus. That's how the shots are being done. So your body is going to get what I call the germ. Now the body, God made this body perfect, is going to develop some antibodies, which we call, I call them the soldiers. So the soldiers are ready to fight that disease when you get that shot. So it's, they produce the soldiers. So when you go into an area or in a situation, now I'm exposed to that disease, the soldiers, they wake up and they recognize that disease and they're ready to fight it. So we're going to get some of the viruses or bacteria are live and some of them are not live. And I'll talk about that later. But that's the main thing. So you get exposed to the germ, your body develops these soldiers, which is your antibodies, and that's going to fight whatever disease it is that we're talking about. We are protecting ourselves, okay? So they imitate the infection, and here we go. So what types of vaccines do we have? And it's mainly three types. And this is not very important to understand later on why I need it, but I wanted you to be today to understand why it's important and what type of vaccine it is that you're getting. And when you know your neighbors are asking you some question, I'm hoping that you're going to be my cheerleaders too, to continue to promote that vaccines are important, you have some understanding of how they work. So there are some that are live. That means that's a live attenuated vaccine. The virus is still alive, or the bacteria. They has been weakened because we don't want to give you, you know, a bad disease right away. They have been weakened, but that's how you're going to be exposed to it. Some examples is the chickenpox, the MMR, the shingles. That's also a live vaccine. Other vaccines is what we call inactivated vaccines. So they're not alive. They're killed viruses or bacteria. And examples of that is the flu shot or the polio. And you have also some vaccines that have toxoid. Toxoid means toxins, means poison. So they take that bacteria, they take that poison from that bacteria, and they take a part of it, and that forms the vaccine. So this prevents diseases caused by bacteria that produces the poisons in your body. For example, the tetanus, diphtheria, and pertussis vaccine. So that's from a bacteria, the poison from the bacteria. So it sounds scary, right? So a lot of people now are like, why am I going to put some toxins in my body and you're telling me I have to be your cheerleader, right? Well, because of the amount being so minuscule, it's still going to protect you then, okay? And some of us are in their 50s, 60s, 65. I'm tired of vaccines. Why do I need more? Like I mentioned earlier, some are recommended only for adults. So the shingles, it's at 50 years old, it start as a recommendation. Some protection wears off over time, so you need your booster's vaccine. And we now have newer that you may not have gotten. When I was born, I didn't get the hepatitis B vaccine because that didn't get introduced. So if you check and you're not immune to it, they do the blood work, they can check for those soldiers I called earlier, the antibodies. If you don't have them, that means you're not protected. So that means we need to revaccinate. So that's why it's important, why more vaccine. And some viruses change, like the flu shot. The flu shot is not the same every year. Every year, CDC, you know, they see the strains that are coming on, and then we predict what's going to be happening next year, and that's how we get the new flu shot. So every year, the flu shot is a different shot. So that's why it's important to get it every year. And higher risk for diseases is also based if you're planning to travel. If you go to India, for example, they have hepatitis A as an endemic, so you have to protect yourself. Some countries have malaria, so you have to protect yourself. Now, if you work in the health departments, we are exposed to everything. So it's better to be protected from everything that needs to be vaccinated. We need to get them. Okay? And then certain jobs, some people work in research. When you work in research, you're going to be exposed to anything, any tissue that they give you, and you don't know sometimes what they have. So they need to be protected because they can get that disease. So this is what we have for the adults. There are 14 deadly diseases that we can protect ourselves. We may not go necessarily all of them, but if there's any of them that you are interested, please just ask the question. Let's discuss them. Shingles, hepatitis B, the whooping cough, which is pertussis, mumps, measles, the tetanus, rubella, influenza, which is the flu, pneumonia, which comes from the pneumococcal disease, meningitis, so there is a way of protecting us from meningitis, the chicken pox, which is usually in children, but you can have the booster as an adult, diphtheria, HPV, like you mentioned, which is the first cancer vaccine we have, and hepatitis A. So these are the 14 recommended vaccines for adults. So, Okay, HPV, so there we go. So HPV, it's indicated for kids from the ages of 9 to 26. It is the first cancer prevention vaccine, and you need 2 or 3 doses depending on the age that you got it. Most of the CDC still recommend 3 doses. So you get one, then a month later you get another one, then 6 months later you get the third booster. It's not recommended until after pregnancy, but it is not a live vaccine. Remember we talked about it being alive or not, since it's not alive, it doesn't really hurt the mom if you get it, and then you find out you're pregnant. It's just recommended not during pregnancy. Hepatitis A. So hepatitis A, at any age, you can have it. If you haven't had the vaccine and you're planning to travel, protect yourself. You can get it at any age. And these are 2 doses. You usually get 1, and then 6 months later or a year later, you can have the number 2. Now, if you are an at-risk patient, it is recommended to get it. And who are those people? If you have a chronic liver disease, like cirrhosis, you can have even fatty liver. A lot of people think, oh, fatty liver is just fat in the liver. You can get cirrhosis from a fatty liver, so we need to protect ourselves. Men who have sex with men, IV drug users, homelessness, because that all is endemic in that population, researchers in the laboratory, and also if you have people that work with international adoptees because they're bringing kids from outside, sometimes those little babies can have hepatitis A, and as an adult, you can get the hepatitis A. And if you're going to travel in those countries. So what do we see here? Anything strikes you on this picture? Jaundice, exactly. So this is a man with hepatitis A, and his eyes are all yellow. Even his skin is yellowish tint, and that is from the hepatitis. So it's not as severe and dangerous like hepatitis B and C, but it still causes liver damage and jaundice. Now, Haemophilus influenza type B, or HIP, this is not the same as the influenza, okay? This is a bacteria. Usually, it's mainly in children that you have to do it, but if you have your spleen removed, it is recommended for you to have the HIP. Haemophilus influenza. And that's 2 or 3 doses depending on what age you're getting them. So patients that have leukemia, for example, they're going to have stem cell transplant. Your immune system is low. You need this vaccine as well. Or sickle cell disease. Hepatitis B. So this is a big one that I like to talk about because this is something that is fairly new. And the best thing we're doing is just getting all our babies, all children now, are immunized. And it's 3 doses. So they get it when they're in the hospital at birth. 1 month later, it's okay to get it at 2, but usually at 1 month later and 6 months later, they get the booster. And then you will say, wait a minute, doc, we're talking about adults here. I'm not a 2-month-old or a 6-month-old, but maybe you're not immune for it because you didn't get it as a child. So if you did not get it as a child, you can get it now. I'm not sure if I got it. discuss with your doctor. They can do a blood test to see if you have the antibody, if you are protected. If you are not, you need it, and it's three doses. Same thing. So you get day number one, then you come back to the doctor a month later, and then back to the doctor 6 months later for your hepatitis B vaccine. Special situations. If you have hepatitis C, even if you had your hepatitis B vaccine several years ago, your liver doctor is usually going to ask you to revaccinate again, get a booster, because your liver may be damaged already. Yeah. Yes, unfortunately they can, and some of them do. Yeah, and that's one of the things that I'm happy that you brought it up, because that is how we get a lot of diseases that have been eradicated and now they're coming back. For example, measles. You've been seeing it in the news. So what happened is that kid never had a shot before. Now they get exposed to hepatitis B. They're going to get hepatitis B, but now they're also going to be transmitting it to other kids that either never had it or to a patient that has cancer. Or even, let's say, if you have rheumatoid arthritis, you have to take some medications like Humira. That's like chemotherapy. Those people, just for the rheumatoid, you're not even a cancer, you're a rheumatoid arthritis patient, now you have the chance of getting that hepatitis because that child was not immunized and now it's given to the whole community. So that's why we're saying when you're not immunized, you're not only making it bad for you, but it's for your neighbor, your family, and your community.
When we think about, like, is there an international standard for giving
this shot to newborns? Most of the countries, yes, are doing it now. That is part of the immunization that is worldwide because we want to eradicate it. And some places, they don't get it. Like in New Jersey, they had the measles outbreak too. And there were some immigrants that just came back from Africa because they didn't have the immunization. And that's how they brought it over to New Jersey. It's like 18 people, I think, got the measles outbreak. And again, so then you have those other, you know, that are concerned about autism. There's a lot of parents out there because it has tamoxifen. Tamoxifen is kind of a mercury derivative. Studies are showing there's no evidence of autism and vaccination. None.
Some parents prefer to wait like 2 months until their baby's immune system grows a little bit more. Is that okay?
Yes, but just hope that during those 2 months, you're not exposed. But it's okay because they're going to have the other ones anyways, because at 2 months, you have to have, you know, your polio, all the other vaccine. Yeah.
Which is very concerning because it's a very angry group of people that are not based, that have no scientific basis whatsoever. Right. And you would know that these are not recent immigrants from Africa. These are American, educated, well-educated, that are misinforming the public and have these social forums. Yeah.
Yeah. And you have some celebrities, and then because you're a celebrity, they think they are experts in everything, promoting this, you know. So, yeah, exactly.
A story about the young fella who became 18 and went to get his.
Yes, I love that. I love that. I saw that. That he just decided, after all the information he got, to tell the parents, I'm getting all my shots. So that is an educated young man. Yes. 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 But
I thought it was great on his part.
Yes, exactly, because there are several his age, because if he is on that age already, uh-huh. you know that the parents, there are other parents out there with the, that did the same.
Their religious beliefs that, you know, when they're born, well, you're under 18, you're at your parents' mercy for everything. They're responsible, so
right.
they opt out of all of those.
Yeah, but that's
where their problems begin with health.
Right. And the nice thing is to see this man, young man,
exactly.
being responsible and say, no, I have to spread this.
Mm-hmm. Right. Hopefully that's on social media.
Yeah. More, yes.
Derogatory.
Yeah. I don't think so, but most of the schools that you go to, it's required to bring your immunizations. So the only time that I've had kids that were not up to date, they will, the school will ask me to write a letter, the reason why the kid cannot have their immunization. So if the parents ask me because of their beliefs, I cannot, as a, you know, as a scientific person, say, you're excused. I always recommend the immunizations. Unless, you know, maybe the flu shot, if some of them are made out of eggs, but now we have newer vaccine. In the past, if you were allergic to eggs, you couldn't get certain immunizations, but not anymore. Now they're making it not, they don't make it from eggs only. So there's eggs-free, so the people that are allergic to eggs. Or if some kid had a bad reaction, then you may kind of rethink about immunizing. But going back to your question, public school or private school, you still have to have an immunization record. It's still required. Yeah. So this is a hepatitis B. Lady, that's a cirrhosis. So all that is ascites, the fluid that is in there. So that is what we would like to prevent. Yep. So that is the hepatitis, unfortunately. And MMR, which is the measles, mumps, and rubella, this is a live vaccine. So again, live vaccines, we cannot give them to patients that have cancer, are immunocompromised like HIV. Sometimes during pregnancy too, it's contraindicated because it's a live vaccine, okay? So this one, if you were born before 1957, anybody here? So you probably may need a booster on that, but before you do it, you can just ask your doctor, you know.
I had a titer done. Still,
you're still immune. Perfect. Because this one is, if you're before 50, there's another one, maybe the pertussis, the DTaP, because that's a big one that we are recommending now because of the mainly the pertussis part, the whooping cough, because we adults are transmitting to the babies because our immunity is fading away. So maybe that might be the age where there was, yeah. But this, you know, the 1957 is one because we're thinking that your immunity is going down. So the titers, I'm happy to hear that you did have the titers, because that's the only way you will know at your age if you need it or not. So you go to your doctor and say, Doc, I think I need my titers from my MMR. You'll impress him or her.
Back then, we had the diseases. I've had all of them.
Yeah. Yeah. My grandmother used to.
To
your immunity, exactly. Yes, yes. I remember as a child, I'm the youngest from all the cousins. And if one got measles, they would push them all, and then you go in with your cousins, and they have all this rash and all this thing. I'm like, I really don't want it, but that's how I got immunized. So because it's a live virus, it's contraindicating during pregnancy. HIV patients with AIDS are immunocompromised. Again, and my rheumatoid arthritis patients. All those live vaccines, we have to be careful on with the live vaccines, okay? Meningitis, this is also mainly in children or if you live in a close community, like the military, or kids when they go into dorms, because it's a very, very highly contagious through drops. So if they cough, they can get it, but it gives you meningitis. It goes to the brain. And this is two doses, 8 weeks apart. So you get one, then in 2 months you get your booster. Now this one, if you have high risk, they recommend to revaccinate every 5 years if you still have the risk. What is the risk? Spleen removed again, because that's where, you know, some of the protection happened there. Your sickle cell disease, HIV patients, and if you're going to travel in endemic countries, get your meningitis. Because we all know meningitis is not something that you want to get. It's deadly. You know, you read in the newspaper, 16 years old died, meningitis. And it's just a vaccine. So for me, it's hard to read things like that when I know we have the tools, we have the ways to prevent it. All right, who got their flu shot this year? Okay, good. Oh, well, I mean, last year. Yeah, for this, okay, good, for last year. It's annually, like I said, it changes every year, so that's why we need to do it annually. We had 80,000 people die of flu season, 17, 18, 18,000. So we can do better with our immunizations to protect ourselves. It starts from 6 months to all ages. Now, if you are 65 or older, this is something new, a high-dose flu vaccine. Yes. Yes. Why? Because they are increased risk of dying from the flu. So that's why you have to have the high-dose flu shot, okay? Now, can you get the flu from the flu shot? Right. So a lot of, you know, people said, yeah, I got the shot and I got sick the next day. Well, it can be true because it takes 2 weeks from when you get the shot for your soldiers. Remember talking about the antibodies? For you to be immune to the flu shot. So it's 2 weeks. So if you get it today, you're not protected tomorrow. So if you got exposed already, somebody had the flu, you got the shot the next day, but you already have the flu in you, you're going to develop it. The flu vaccine, even if it's given within the time period, you may have some form of it, but it's not as severe as if you didn't get the shot. So you're protected there too, okay? Protection starts 2 weeks after the shot, and shot protect from different strain every year. So that's why, oh yes, I got it 2 years ago. Well, it's not gonna protect you the same year. And I have some patients that they come very late, they decide to in March. Let me get it now. Can you get it today or tomorrow? Yes, you can, because we still have some cold fronts coming in, and whenever there's the cold front, that's the time that you can get the flu. So just be aware of that, okay? That you can have a strain, even if I get it in March 2019, but September, that shot is going to be different than what you just had in March. So you cannot then say, but I just got my shot in March of this year. I'm protected for next year. No, we're not. You still need to get it starting September, October, November. That's the best time because the flu season usually starts December, January, February when it's still cold. Well, the antibodies can be still in your body. So if you get exposed, if let's say one of the flu strain comes back the next years, your body's still going to recognize that. So the more you have, the more protection you have because of the variety of strains that we have. But it's not going to protect you really against other diseases.
No, but your immunity remains. So if one came back again, you would still...
Yeah. It doesn't disappear. Exactly, exactly. And, you know, and it's a guess. So CDC doesn't really know which flu we're going to get. They're guessing, you know, I don't know how they do that job, but we have to have professionals everywhere, right? In the lab trying to figure out which flu is going to come. Oh, I think it's going to be the B-15, or, you know. And here we go. And hopefully they guess the right one. Exactly. All right. So pneumonia. This is kind of confusing because you're hearing a lot of on the advertisement on TV, if you never had any of the shots, this is the one you have to have. Well, there's two different types, and I'm just going to call them 13 because that's for 13 strains of pneumonia, and 23 because there's one other one that is 23. If you are age 65, you need to receive one dose of the 13. A year after that, you receive the 23. And it's easy. 13 is smaller than 23, right? So you get the 23 first, and then, I mean the 13 first, and then the 23. Now, if you're between 19 and 64, so you're not 65 yet, and you have some chronic conditions, like you had a heart attack, you had a stent placed, you have lung or liver disease, you're diabetic, alcoholic, or you are a smoker. You can be a super healthy marathon runner, but you are a smoker. That increases the risk of pneumonia too. You have to have a dose of the 13, and 2 months later, you get the 23. Now, the booster is only for the 23 every 5 years now, if you are still having the same risks. So the 23 you have more frequent. Then you hit 65. You got your 13 already. You don't need it again. You got it. But you need your 23. And that's going to be your last dose of the 23. If you do not remember getting the 13, because like I said, this is something that we are promoting now, get your 13 first at 65. Then the next year at 66, you get your 23. But then you're not protected. Yeah. If you never had the 23, you're not protected. And that has 23 strains of pneumonia type that you can get. No, you just do it. Let's say you had the 23, went to the office, they don't have the 13. Get your 23. The next year you get your 13. Okay? For some reason, they want us to have that separate by that amount of time because of the age and the higher risk. Because people, like I mentioned earlier, 50,000 people died from pneumonia last year. Not a season, just last year. The only that they count is the season for the flu. And then these are estimates, because there's a lot of patients that get these diseases that we don't know that they have them. They don't report it. They don't go to the doctors. So they don't know that they even have them. So the mortality numbers we're getting are only from CDC that were reported. So it's probably a low number. It's not the real number that we'll see.
So the 13 are different
things
from the 23?
Yes. I love it. I love it. Well, you know what? I'm going to go ahead and ask them to see if we can add them on into one. Yeah, combine them.
Yeah.
I like how you think. Yes. I'm gonna pursue it, and I'll let you know. I'll send you some answer. I'm sorry. Yeah. Which one you had, but you know you had one? Yeah. So probably, yeah, we can probably do titers. It's not something that we do titers most likely, because it's very hard to see, 13 strains. So if you don't know, it will not hurt. So I would just wait to get it again. So I would just wait a year, though, before you get the other one, and depending on your age. If you're 65, definitely I will go with the 13 first. And then the next year you do the 23. If you're not sure, get the 23 if you're younger than 65.
So
So probably, yes, but not the 23 anymore, so just not the 13 anymore, just the 23 every 5 years, because the risk is still there. Okay, so then that one, you know, because now our, you know, women, we are dying at the age of 85 to 90. So my point is still, okay, you're sentencing 65, we're done. But what if I'm 90? How do I know that my immune system is still good? So there are some studies that they're trying to see if they need to bring back the boosters for the pneumovax as well. The 23 is the pneumovax. So they're talking, there's some studies going on that for that same reason, that we need to make sure to, you know, our patients are aging, so we need to protect them. Not the 13. The 13. Yeah, the pneumovax is the old one that we used to, you know, we adults didn't used to have the 13, but all of a sudden, children are getting sick with the 13, and that's why they start saying, oh, it must be our older population that are bringing it, so let's go ahead and get started. So that's why the whole campaign started. If you're not going to get any, this is the one you have to. Of course, I don't believe that. I think you have to have them all, but that's how it came about. The 13 is the newest one. Yeah, it's newest for the adults, but it's older in the kids, because that's what they recommend for the kids. Yeah, yeah.
The commercial on TV, they have like pneumonia or something.
Right.
Is that just a strain of pneumonia?
Well, the pneumococcal is the bacteria.
Oh, okay.
And then the pneumococcal, the one on TV, the pneumococcal, that's a 13 that they're talking about. It has 13 strains of the pneumococcal bacteria. All right, so this is another one that is kind of on the go. You know, I keep talking about the pertussis, the whooping cough. So luckily, this is three shots in one. So we're going to have to get that pneumonia shot, two shots in one. I'm gonna try to pursue that, yeah. So tetanus, diphtheria, and pertussis, the Tdap. So the tetanus booster is every 10 years. That's if you cut your finger with something that it's rusted, you can have the tetanus, which is the locked jaw. It's a very painful disease. And this, you know, people tend to forget that we need to get it every 10 years, because 10 years is a hard time to remember, but we need it. So what we recommend now is the Tdap, one dose only, after you're 60. Then you can continue with the TD booster. The Tdap, that's for the pertussis. That's the one that we are seeing the comeback of the whooping cough. If you're pregnant, this is a dead virus, a dead bacteria. So this is not, remember we're talking about the life. This is not a life. Actually, this is the toxin. This is the poison. But it's not life. So pregnant ladies can get it, and it is recommended for the pregnant ladies. And you get one dose of the Tdap, which each pregnancy. You have five pregnancies, guess what? Give five shots. Because that newborn baby can get that whooping cough. So that's what you're doing. Every baby you get, you have to protect that baby. So it is important for, you know, moms to know, if you have any daughters, daughters-in-law, just make sure that you mention it to them. And you, as a grandparent, too, want to protect, because you don't want to give them the whooping cough.
It's a commercial that is coming on television where they brought grandbaby over, the baby was dressed in red, and the grandmother turned into a wolf.
Yeah. Yes.
Because of the
Whooping cough. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. It's coming back. And it's a whooping cough. This little kid here has a whooping cough. They cannot stop coughing, and it's like a dog, and they're breathing. So, you know, if you're starting to have a cough, just make sure that you had that one Tdap. It's only one Tdap. And then the tetanus booster. All right. Varicella. This is the chicken pox. So if you had it as a child, you're protected. Your titers are going to be there. But most of the kids now are, maybe this is the one you're talking to, those born in 1980 or later. So that's the chicken pox. Oh, in the 60s. Then it's down. Okay. Immunization. So I remember which one. Okay. So in the 60s, because that's... Maybe the measles, because they were talking about the 1957 year, but probably that's why we're talking about boosters too, because we're seeing it in the country. So this one is a live vaccine. So who cannot get this shot? Right, right. Okay, you're paying attention, just making sure. And it's a 4 to 8 weeks apart, so they get one. 2 months later, they get another one. Healthcare personnel with no evidence of immunity. So if you're going into a nursing or CSR, whatever position there are in the health personnel, do the titers. Because if you're not immunized, you're going to need to have the chickenpox. Now, shingles is also chickenpox virus. But if you never had the chickenpox vaccine, we want the chickenpox vaccine as a healthcare provider first. Because remember, the shingles is at 50 or and above, and late and older. So you want to have the chickenpox then. It's contraindicated in pregnancy and immunocompromised. And here's the shingles now. So it is a live virus, so no pregnancy, no immunocompromised patient, HIV, rheumatoid arthritis, on medication for it, no. And it starts at age 50, and there's two types. So some of you may say, hey, I got my Zostavax 3 years ago. That was the only vaccine then, but it only protects you about 50%. Shingrix is the newer one that came out. So that's the new, I put that first because that is the preferred. It is 98% protection, so a lot better than the Zostavax. So it is a series of two shots. You get one, then 2 months later, between 2 and 6 months, you can get number two. Now, so many people got immunized with the first shot that we ran out. It was on back order. Up to last week, Publix finally got some in. So they're fine, yeah. So there were a lot of people that couldn't get their booster. Luckily, it's 6 months' time. You can still get it to boost your immunity back. Zostavax is one dose, but again, CDC is recommending, even if you got your Zostavax, you should have a Shingrix. Now, the difference here is, if you get the Shingrix 2 months after the Zostavax, you're fine, but then nobody probably got the Shingrix after the Zostavax because it's a newer vaccine. So you need to have your series of two shots. One now, then 2 to 6 months later, number two. Okay? The Shingrix. Yeah, that's right. For the Shingrix?
Medicare doesn't cover it at all.
At all.
And my supplement, of course. Yeah. If Medicare don't cover it, the supplement doesn't.
Doesn't either. So. And that's something that I think they should. It's so painful, you're going to end up in the ER.
Exactly.
So it's going to cost the insurance more money than to give the vaccine. Yeah, and it's a Part D, okay?
Yeah,
it's a drug coverage.
But I'm referring to those with commercial insurance.
Right,
even.
Yeah. So it's a Part D, but you have to ask
if
they pay for it. So I would call your customer service on your card to see. Now, if you have GatorCare, luckily, they pay for it. Yes, yeah, for free. And you can go to Publix and you can get it. I used to give the Zostavax in my office to all GatorCares for free, but now, yes, GatorCare Publix, and they have them in now. But since the Shingrix came out, we're not doing the Zostavax anymore because we want to promote the Shingrix.
Okay, so we'll need two Shingrix.
Two Shingrix, yeah. You get one, and then your pharmacist is going to tell you two. 2 to 6 months later, number two. Yeah. Yes, I'm sorry to say, but the Shingrix shot hurts. It hurts.
I'm sorry, but I guess when they had the first dose, the lady was telling me it didn't hurt. One of the coworkers,
that second hurt more. So because the Shingrix hurt for some, I don't know why, for some reason. What I tell people is, my patients, when you go get it, take a Tylenol before you get it, and then as soon as you get it, put some ice to see, to numb it and help you out there, because it does hurt. No, the shingles, for some reason, is worse than the tetanus. That, but that's not an excuse not to get your shot.
Get a lollipop with it.
Yes, exactly, exactly. All right. So can I get the zoster shot if I had the shingles before? What do you think? You had the shingles already. Can you still get the shot? Yeah, yeah, yes, because shingles is not a one-time disease. It can come back and back and back. So by getting the shot, it's going to protect you from either getting it less, or if you get it, it's not as painful, because it's a very painful. Well, what happened is the chickenpox, when you get the chickenpox virus, it goes dormant. It goes to sleep in your spine, in your nervous system. And then the chickenpox virus then now comes as a shingles, because it's not chickenpox anymore. So it goes on the nerve, what we call the dermatome. So that's why it's only half of the body. It can be on your face. It can be on the side, in the cheeks, because it's just that nerve pain. And that's why it's so painful, because it attacks the nerve. Usually when you're sick, you're not sleeping well, you're stressed, that makes your immune system low. It comes on the dermatome. It goes away. That's outbreak, lasted maybe 14 days. You can still have long, long time nerve pain without the rash, but you can have another outbreak to another nerve dermatome. So that's why it's not really the protection from that necessarily. You can still have it again, but by giving the shot, hopefully that will help with the immunity. To the eyes, to the eyes, because it can go and cause blindness. So if you get the shingle, because you have different, what we call cranial nerves, nerves in the face. If you get it from the trigeminal, it can come in those three places, or just the facial, and if it gets the eye, it's a devastating thing. You have to see the eye doctor right away. So, you know, your primary will give you your antiviral, your pain, and all that, but you need to see the eye doctor right away.
It's very contagious.
Yes. Well, it's not contagious, because remember, it's the chickenpox virus that is in you. The only way it's contagious is a newborn who never got the chickenpox vaccine, and you have a shingles blister. If that baby gets exposed to that, they get chickenpox. So you don't transmit shingles. You transmit chickenpox. So the baby will have chickenpox.
My sister, she gets them over there, but they never come on the outside. They're always on the inside.
The nerve. It's a pain. Yeah. Yeah. And some people have it prolonged chronically. That's what we call the post-herpetic neuralgia. Neuralgia means nerve pain. It's after, because the chickenpox is a herpes virus. You know, a lot of people think herpes is just sexually. No, chickenpox is a herpes virus. So that's what they call PHN, post-herpetic neuralgia. It's so painful, like your sister is having, because of the nerve. Chickenpox. Yeah. What I would... Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you know, he can check the titers too. Because when I was doing my residency at the hospital here, I had a patient with, I think it was chickenpox. And I thought, you know, my grandma, remember, put me in the room with all of them. So we had some lady very sick in the MICU, dying from pneumonia from the chickenpox. So they ask, who here has not gotten the chickenpox? Because they don't want you to go take care of a sick person. Here I am. Oh, I'm sure I got it. I didn't. So I'm taking care of the lady. 2 weeks later, high fever, broke out. I got the chickenpox. So You know, so make, he can just check the titer. That will be the easiest thing. Then, because if he has titers positive for chickenpox, then he needs the shingles. If it's not, you can have the chickenpox.
It's worse than
many. Yeah.
If you've had chickenpox,
yeah,
with those immunities, and you still have your immunities, because I have the titer and they told me, does that also help to ward off some of the shingles?
Hopefully, yes. Some of the immunity, yes. Okay. It all depends on your immune system still, because remember, it goes asleep in your body. Yeah, and then, you know, if something should happen, and that's why at this age, we don't need to stress. You know, the world can be falling. We can say, okay, that's fine. Let me pick up and see what else I'm going to do without the stress, right? Because it's harmless for us to get stressed. Yeah.
I just wondered, in the hospital, they put them on isolation.
Yes.
And they say if there's bleeding sores, you know, that they can be, you can be exposed to it.
Yes. Yeah. Right here. The weeping sores, because that's where some of the viruses are. And if you are, you know, in the hospital, you have a lot of immunocompromised. So then that can still then be transmitting the virus. And that can get bacterial infection on top of it. So now you have the shingles plus a bacterial infection from the skin, a cellulitis on top of it. So that means more treatment that needs to happen. But like you see here, it goes half through his chest. It didn't cross over because the derm, the nerve, is from the back, the spine, it comes half of the body. At 50. No.
Okay.
Yeah, because you're protected already with your chicken pox, but then at 50, that's a newer vaccine, remember, that we talked about?
Yes.
So that's the shingles. Yeah. So that's the, now they're an adult. Now they need their adult immunization. Yeah.
What about the mouth?
Oh, yes. Yeah, the pot, yeah. And you cannot swallow. And some of those, in children, it can be the hand, foot, and mouth disease, that it's a, you know, kind of a virus. But, you know, they can have some sores, even measles. The measles, it's, they cannot swallow. That's why they dehydrate. And you can die from it by being dehydrated. And they're very painful. Very painful diseases. So, to make it simple now, okay? Vaccine at age 65. So we can just, instead of all the 14, I think this is important. Flu every year, pneumonia 13, pneumococcal 13, one dose. Pneumonia 23, that's the pneumovax, one dose. Looking more attractive now, right? Instead of all these other ones. Your Tdap, that's the one with the pertussis, the whooping cough, one dose. Your tetanus shot every 10 years after you have your Tdap, you know, it's in 10 years, and your shingle shot, the two doses, because that's the Shingrix. Maybe I should have had handouts for that one. Yes, anybody who's interested? Okay, yes, I'll be. Good.
Okay.
So, okay, go back. Then 50, it's very similar. Your flu every year. The 13, just the one, but then followed by the 23, you can have that with one in 2 months. So it's not one dose anymore, though, because you have to rebooster at 65. So I'm going to say then at 50, you have one of the pneumonia 13, two of the pneumonia 23, because you get it at 50, but then when you hit 65, you need another shot of the pneumonia, okay? Your Tdap, one dose. tetanus every 10 years, and the shingles, 2 doses. It's exactly the same, except the 13, and the 23, except the 23, you need 2. At 50, and then booster at 65. If you got your pneumonia 13 at 50, you don't need it again at 65. You got it. But you need that 23 again. Okay?
Older than 65. So do you need to start from the 50 age of...
The 65, yeah. 65 or 65 and older, you're still a young 65. Okay? Like that, and you're still a young 65.
On the hepatitis, how about those? How often hepatitis A, is there a booster? And hepatitis B, a booster?
Only if you cannot show that you have the immunity. So the hepatitis B is 3 shots.
Okay, but if you've got actual disease.
Okay, then you're at high risk. Then we will put you with the A and the B. Like
yeah,
if you're
I've
being treated. Right.
How often do I need
the booster? If you just have the one booster, that is all they're recommending.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, yeah. You had a question?
The Tdap.
Mm-hmm. You wait 10 years. No, no. You got the Tdap today.
So I'm waiting 10 years.
For the TD booster.
The
TD. Exactly. Because it already has the tetanus, it has the diphtheria, but it's the pertussis that that is not in there.
Say if I have the Tdap, which I have, in the past 2 years, I won't need any booster until the Tdap ever again.
Right. Unless you have, somebody pregnant in the family that is close to you and you want to protect the newborn, then you can just have that, but only one. If you are 65, it's just a one, and that's it. Yeah. Oh. Yeah, the Tdap. Yeah. No. No, if you turn 65 and yes, TD every 10 years, yeah.
So the Tdap is the one like you said, like when you go in the woods and you step on something. Is that what that is?
That's the T. There's a tetanus, so that's part of the Tdap and part of the TD. So the tetanus shot. So the tetanus shot is with the Tdap. And the tetanus shot is with a TD. That's what the T stands for, is for tetanus.
Okay, so you must have given that last year, but you said 10 years.
Yes. So then you're good for 10 years. Now, if you just got the tetanus shot only, that does not include the pertussis, that whooping cough. And that's the one that we are still, it is coming back. So that's the one that we're still recommending for patients at the age of 65 to get a booster of that. So instead of at 65 getting a tetanus shot only, you get a tetanus with the pertussis. That's the Tdap.
Well, she should know.
I'm
not talking about because she gives it to
She should know all of that. Yes. And then if not, you're just going to say, listen, I just went to this talk. Let me see if you're up to date with what we need to hear. Okay? Which one did I get? Did I get the TD or the Tdap? I love it when my patients come with things writing up and I have to, I answer them all on their paper, but I love it because then they go home and they have the answers right there. Yeah. I was thinking maybe I should bring some shots here, to give people. Oh, which one do you need? All right. So this now I'm just going to go to some myths and facts because I thought that was something fun for us to do. So you just tell me if it's a myth or if it's a fact. The flu shot gives you the flu.
No.
No. Yes. Flu shot saves lives.
Yes.
Yeah, it's a fact. Shingles is not contagious. Yes. That's a myth. Because we remember, if the blisters are open, you can give chickenpox. Any older people can get shingles. Yeah. Oh, I mean, only older people can. Yeah. No. You cannot treat shingles. Myths, because you can give them the antiviral to treat it. You can still have a recurrence, so you don't only get it once. You can only get shingles once. I just said it. Myth. Now, a vaccine can help prevent many diseases. A fact. Stress can trigger shingles. A fact. And the rash can get infected. So, very good. So, I think we did good. So, in conclusion, vaccines protect you from illnesses and from death. It protects your family, your neighbors, your community. You do not get diseases from immunization, and they save lives. Like I said, 80,000 people died in the flu season 2017, 2018. 50,000 people died from pneumonia last year. So that's a lot of bodies that we can save. So I found this picture in Dr. Harry Hull is an epidemiologist, worked with the CDC, very well-known doctor. And he put, this was back in 2005, how can we continue to tolerate polio when we have the technical expertise to get rid of it? And that's a little boy with polio. In 2019, I want to take his same words, but I would say, how can we continue to tolerate preventable diseases when we have the technical expertise to get rid of them? So immunizations, even though there's a lot of people that don't think that they're necessary, we are eradicating diseases, we're saving lives, and we are saving communities, neighborhoods, and family. So any questions? Yes, now with the IPV. Yeah, not the oral anymore. You can get it now through the shots.
Yeah,
I
remember
standing in line.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think I was probably 15 then.
Yeah.
And they, because I grew up during the polio.
Yeah. So you.
I lived in Miami, and there was a children's hospital not far from our house. And I remember all the.
And the kids. I mean, it was deformed.
I have a classmate that had, she lived in the iron lung.
Exactly. So, you know, when you see that, and then just by having the vaccine to protect, you know, and especially when you've seen it, it's like, we don't want to go back there. I mean, even the smallpoxes, when I saw that picture, it's like, you don't want to go back there. Yeah. And these are some references, you know, the CDC. There's also an advisory committee on immunization, ACIP, that you know you use a lot, or the AFB, so where I got the information. Any questions? No? Thank you. Well, it was a pleasure. Yeah.
If someone's tried, and they're interested in what unusual kinds of things they might need an immunization for if they're traveling someplace, do they get that through their family doctor? Is there a travel clinic that they should go to?
Yeah, there is. Usually the primary care clinic doctors will not have all the immunization. Yellow fever, malaria, and some others. So there is a passport clinic, they call it, or travel clinic, and they can get all the vaccine that are needed there. Even to question, okay, I'm going to this country, what vaccine should I have? Health department too, and the health department.
That's part of UF?
No, it's not part of UF. Yes. Yeah, it's like the health department. You can also get it through the health department. Yeah, there's the passport clinic is a private office, but they're very good because they just kind of give you each country what is the requirements when you travel to that country. But if you don't, you know, I can try to see if I can send you that number too. But the health department too, you can have it from the health department. Yeah.
I'll also include that in the message so people will have it. I think that would be really useful.
Could you Google it?
Or Google.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
This was wonderful. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.